155 years. But the reality is that farms like Beverly's that have been around for so long are rare, because it's getting harder and harder to earn a living in small towns and rural communities. And that's not right. We lose something that's distinctly American when we lose our family farms. But it's happening, and there's a reason for it. While you're working in the fields, Washington lobbyists are working in Congress to block the rural reforms that are needed. Rather than investing in rural opportunity, our government has been handing out too many subsidies to big business. Over the past decade, our government has handed out $1.3 billion in family farm money, in federal farm money, to people who aren't even farmers. Let me repeat that. Over the past decade, our government has handed out $1.3 billion in federal farm money to people who aren't even farmers. We've even got farm money going to Fortune 500 companies. And you know what happens as a result? It's getting oftentimes harder for the family farmer to turn a profit. It's getting easier for large agribusiness concerns to buy out family farms. The game's been rigged, so you only see 20 cents for every dollar American spends on food. For an expensive steak, you get less than a dollar. For a loaf of bread, you get less than a dime. For a box of cereal, you get even less. Now, the farm bill that's before Congress right now, that just passed out of the House today, offers a real opportunity to review how we can make sure our government is serving family farmers and rural communities across the board and not just serving the few. In addition, it provides an opportunity to strengthen the range of efforts to protect and conserve our natural resources like land and water and promote rural economic development. Your own senator, Senator Tom Harkin, has been an outstanding leader on this issue. He's going to be the key driver behind the Senate agricultural bill. And Tom already indicated to me, and I think since publicly impressed, that the Senate bill is not going to entirely copy the House bill. It's going to put more emphasis on conservation, more emphasis on nutrition, and it's probably going to be more aggressive in terms of making sure that subsidies are going to the people that really need them, as opposed to the folks who've got the most clout in Washington. And I look forward to working with him as the bill moves forward through Congress. Now, I know that many of you may be a little bit cynical about this whole process, because every few years you get politicians out here making promises about how things are going to change in Washington. But I come from a farm state, and I think it's fair to say that I've got a record for battling on behalf of you, for being a strong advocate for rural communities. I've been fighting to pass a comprehensive energy plan in Congress that brings us closer to the day when renewable energy is the rule and not the exception in this country. As one part of a comprehensive plan, I've been one of the key movers on the ethanol program in Washington. This is an issue where we're in an era of great opportunity for American farmers. Since 1990, farmer co-ops have been responsible for 50% of new ethanol production capacity, and I've been fighting to make sure that all of you have a chance to continue to lead the way on renewable energy futures. This year, I joined Tom Harkin in introducing the Biofuel Security Act so we can drastically increase biofuels in our national fuel supply and get half of all our gas stations and all our consumer vehicles to be E85 compatible within a decade. I proposed the Fill-Up Act to call on oil companies that make at least $1 billion in profits each quarter to invest at least 1% into installing E85 pumps. And I passed a bill that gave tax credits to gas stations to take the initiative in installing E85 pumps on their own. This is all against the backdrop of fighting to make sure that we enact the renewable fuel standard so we can add more than $7 billion of ethanol to our national gasoline pool. But I know that all of you are also worried about droughts and weather-related diseases that can put you out of business. A couple of years back, we had a drought in Illinois, some of you remember. And Dick Durbin, our senior Illinois senator, and myself went to the Secretary of Agriculture and made sure our farmers got quick relief. So I know how important that is. We need to make sure to get the disaster assistance to you when we need it. As president, I'll keep on fighting for a rural agenda. I'll enforce our trade agreements and fight to make sure farm programs help the family farmer who needs them. I'll sign a universal health care bill, because I remember the first trip that I took to a farm and discovered that many of the women in farming communities were working just to make sure that they had health insurance for their families. We're going to make sure that every single American has health insurance, and for those who do, and for those who already have health insurance, we're going to make sure to cut their premiums by $2,500 a year, because the cost of health care shouldn't lead to a bankruptcy and cause people to shut down their farms. I'll keep fighting to make sure that rural hospitals are open and we recruit a new generation of doctors and nurses to rural areas. And we'll reinvest in our rural communities by fixing up our failing schools and connecting homes and businesses and hospitals to modern high-speed internet and wireless infrastructure. But let me say this, just to close, and then I'm going to stop talking and I'm going to do most of my time listening. It's going to be hard to make all these changes as long as we're sending $275 million a day to Iraq. It is going to be difficult for us to make the investments that we need. Just to give you a little statistic, for the money this district has spent on this war so far, we could have given more than 211,000 people health care. We could have added more than 15,000 elementary school teachers. Or we could have built 79 new elementary schools. That's just on the money coming out of this congressional district. It's time to make America's rural agenda America's agenda. It's time we had a government that understood that it was the Department of Agriculture, not the Department of Agribusiness. In our democracy, the price of access and influence should be nothing more than your voice and your vote. And that's why when I'm president, I'm going to launch the most sweeping ethics reform in history to make the White House the people's house and send the lobbyists back to K Street. That is going to be the central issue of this election, by the way. That's what ties the rural agenda to the urban agenda. That's what ties issues of agriculture to issues of energy to issues of foreign policy. The question is, are we going to be able to bring about the true and significant changes that America needs to meet its challenges? We can't keep on doing the same stuff all the time. Some of you noticed that this week I got in a debate with one of my colleagues who's also running for the presidency, and the debate was about whether or not we talk to world leaders even when we don't like them. And my theory was you do, and you do without preconditions. And, you know, some of the pundits in Washington, they said, oh, you know, that shows inexperience that he'd be willing to talk to folks. And my attitude was, what do we have to fear as Americans? Why is it that we should be afraid when we've got, if we know who we are, if we know what we stand for, then we shouldn't be afraid to meet anybody, because we'll tell them what we believe and what makes this country great. They may not like what we have to say, but we're going to go ahead and speak to them about those issues. And what's interesting is when I said that, people kind of scratched their head because it wasn't what they were accustomed to hearing. So often in Washington, experience means doing what we've been doing over and over and over again. Well, to me, that's not experience if what you're doing isn't working. It's bad judgment. And if you want to show good judgment, then you've got to be open to changing the way we do things in order to get different outcomes. And that means driving the agenda from here in the heartland, not having it driven by special interests. It means being willing to try new approaches to our foreign policy so that we strengthen our diplomacy. It means that on rural and agricultural issues, that we're not going to keep on doing things the same way when we know that it hasn't worked for rural communities. That's what I'm committed to. That's what I believe is going to make me the President of the United States. That's what I want to partner with you to make happen. So